Hello viewers, welcome to UN Autonomous College. Today we are going to discuss about a new concept that is known as filters in JSP concept. Because we know that whatever user want to do any type of programs, each and every programs must be need to be filtered according to its performance. Now we can focus on a slide. So in this slide already we are going to discuss what are the different concept of filters used in our JSP concept. Now we can focus on this outlines about this topic. First of all, we can learn what are the introductions which are related to our topic, then sublet filter methods which are used in our program, then what are the simple examples related to this topic, then we are learning JSP filter mapping in web.xml file. So last but not least here, filters application order. So these five concepts we are learning in this section. So here we know that the sublet and JSP filters are Java classes that can be used in sublet and JSP programming for the following purposes. Here, to intercept request from a client before they access a resource at backend. Because if a user want to access any type of system, in that moment user must take the help of a client, because without client there is no user backend. Because you know that if a user want to develop a backend, and that backend is always performed through a front end. So that front end is a part of a client side. Whenever user can give any type of parameter, any type of request in the client side, or you can say front end section, then it can perform some action. And that actions must be performed in the base of back end section. So these are some points which are related to this JSP filter. So here, JSP filter concept also provides some Java classes which are known as a predefined classes. By using these predefined classes, we can making a session, and that session helps to be filter its application. So here we need to manipulate responses from server before they are sent back to the client. Because you know that whenever user want to send any kind of request from source side to backend side, so in that moment that backend side also provides some responses, and that type of responses are easily provided or acknowledged through a specific server. If a server is never acknowledged any type of messages to client side section, so in that moment we are missing that our response is totally missed at the time of transmission. So if a user want to doing its correctly transmission between the server and the client, in that moment we must need a filtering section, because at the time of communication we are getting lots of parameters, and some parameters are maybe used for our real resources or may not be used for our real resources. That's why we need to filter out perfectly according to the need of a specific type of user. Next, we are going to discuss there are various types of filters suggested by the specifications. According to the specification, we are dividing, or we can say generating more than one filters. So here we have 9 filters. The first filter named as authentication filters, next one data compression filters, next one encryption filters, then filters that trigger resource access events, then image conversion filters, then logging and auditing filters. Next we are learning MIME, means MIME type chain filters. Last we are learning the tokenizing filters. Last but on list here, XLS, means or by T filters that transform XML content. So these 9 type of filters are used in our JSP concept. By using this 9 type of predefined classes helps to designing a filtering concept in our JSP part. So if a user want to design any type of authentication filters, in that moment user can take the help of this authentication filter part. If a user want to do a data compression movement, in that moment we can take the help of this section that is known as a data compression filters part. So then learning that's the encryption part, then filters the triggering resource part, image conversion filters. These are some filters helps to designing a real application in our JSP part. So next part we are going to discuss here, filters are deployed in the deployment descriptor file. Because you know that whenever user want to design any type of filtering program, so in that moment we need to take the help of that is known as web.xml file. So through that web.xml file we are going to designing a session, and that session is known as a deployment section, or you can say it is a descriptor of deployment part of a JSP concept. So here, if a user want to deploy any type of part, that must be embedded or must be created XML file, and that XML file named as a web.xml. So here, if a user want to design a map to either sublet or JSP names or URL patterns in our application's deployment descriptor. If a user want to develop any type of JSP or Sublet type of programs, so in that moment we are already create, or we can say we can auto-generated a file, and that file is named as a XML file, extensible markup language file, and that markup language file is denoted in the form of web.xml, which is already displayed in this slide. So by using this web.xml file, we can create an application, and that application somehow related to our deployment relevant. That means the whole relevant informations about our project or our applications are referenced in this web.xml file. So that's why this file named as a deployment descriptor file. If a user want to launch or upload this session or project in our server, in that moment this web.xml file helps to be accessed in the server part. So the deployment descriptor file that named as web.xml, which can be found in Tomcat installation directory, or that is known as a config directory. If a user want to create any type of web server relevant application, in that moment this web.xml file by default available in this session. So that's why this deployment descriptor file, which is known as a web.xml file, which is specially used in our Tomcat server application, or you can say GlassBees web server application. Whenever user never want to design this XML part, then there is no problem. But by default, this XML part is automatically generated whenever any type of applications are executed through a server, that may be a Tomcat or GlassBees web server. If a user want to use this type of GlassBees or Tomcat web server, in that moment this session is automatically created. That means this deployment descriptor file is automatically created at the time of execution of a Java file, which is included with a filter application. So if a user want to design a JSP container which starts off your web application, it creates an instance of each filter that you have declared in the deployment descriptor. If a deployment descriptor is designed, so in that moment we are getting some lots of references, and which are already mentioned in a specific order. According to that order, we are creating some parts, which parts are relevant to our JSP filtering session. So here the filters execute in the order that they are declared in the deployment descriptor. That means whenever user want to design any type of filtering application, and this type of application somehow related to our descriptor. If a user is never designed this deployment descriptor session, so in that moment we are getting lots of problem at the time of invocation a specific type of file, that may be a JSP file or that may be a HTML file. So here in this slide already we are mentioning what are the real importance of this web.xml file, or we can say that is known as deployment descriptor file. According to this way of explanation, we are already getting the real map of a specific project. Because if a user want to design a real project, in that moment we are never getting any type of references about our number of web pages. So if a user want to upload a file, or we can say website, in that moment we are already referenced which web page should be open at the time of invoking its URL. If a user is never setted it, then it is arbitrarily opened at any type of web pages at the time of invoking that URL. If a user can invoke a site that named as a www.udanathcollege.org.in, in that moment we are getting a home page, and that home page is already referenced in that XML file. That means this deployment descriptor file, if that file name or web page name is not referenced in this descriptor section, that means whenever user can invoke this file in their web browser, that file name, that means home page, cannot be opened at the time of calling that URL. So if a user want to reference this part of the home page, it must be embedded in that web.xml file, and that web.xml file is a mapping section, and that mapping section is specially designed through a Sublet or JSP or any type of URL patterns which are used in that descriptor section. So and by using that descriptor, we can easily maintaining our different type of web pages in our project. So next slide we are going to discuss what are the different type of Sublet filters are used in our JSP concept. So here a filter is simply a Java class that implements the javax.sublet.filter interface. We know that here filter is known as a interface. That means this interface is already exist in Sublet package, And the servlet package is the advanced Java part. That's why it is denoted as Java X dot servlet dot filter. And here that filter is known as a one type of interface concept. So here that filter interface, or we can say, contains some predefined methods. And what are the different type of methods that are declared here? So first of all, we can say like that public void do filter, and that method named as do filter. D should be small letter, F should be capital. So this method contains three type of parameter. One is known as a sublet request parameter, next sublet response parameter, next filter chain parameter. So this method is called by the container each time a request or response pair is passed through the chain due to a client request for a resource at the end of the chain. If a user want to invoke this file, in that moment this do filter method helps to gathering the more information about our sublet request as well as sublet response file. So if a user is not interested to invoke this method, in that moment we are getting an error. So if a user want to avoid this type of error, we can take the help of any type of logical erroring codings, which are helps to maintain our sublet part very confinedly or very reliable way. So another method named as the init method. What are the real use of that init method? This init method means initialization method, and that method contains a parameter, and that parameter named as filter config, which is already mentioned here. This is one type of variable, and that object name is known as a variable, but here is defined as a filter config. But here this session that is written as a filter config is a predefined class. This predefined class F should be capital and C is also capital, and it contain an object that is named as a filter config, but F should be small because you know it is an object, and we know that the object cannot be a predefined class name. That's why the F should be capital. Instead of this filter config, you can write any name instead of this filter config. That may be obj, whatever you can say. So this method is called by the web container to indicate a filter that is being placed into service. If a user want to make a service of that container, in that moment this init method helps to initialize some default parameters or default value at the time of execution of a JSP page. Third method named as a destroy method. Then what is the use of this destroy method? Here this method is called by the web container to indicate to a filter that it is being just taken out of service. That means if a user has creating their programs or successfully process the request, in that moment we need to close the whole connection. In that moment we can invoke a method named as a destroy method. This destroy method helps to close the whole application or whole creation of that program. So if a user is not interested in doing these things, then we are facing lots of problem at the time of invocation. So here this init method and destroy method, somehow that is known as a, just you can say it is known as optional in nature, but still somehow this destroy method is required to close any type of object which is just used for a long period of time. So this destroy method helps to release that memory session. So next session we are going to discuss how to create a, or we can say how to use a filter part in our JSP program, which is already displayed in this slide. Here it is on programming section. So in this program we can take the help of filtering applications, which is purely defined in a perfect order. So here the following example shows how to print the client's IP address. If a user want to print a client, means a user or can say client IP address, in that moment the current daytime is time it would be accessed any JSP file. So this example will give you a basic understanding of the JSP filter. But you can write more sophisticated filter applications using this concept. So here this slide helps to create a filtering part. So if a user want to invoke this filter program, in that moment we need to import some package. Here we are using four type of package. One is known as IO package, then sublet package, then that is known as sublet HTTP package. Last but not least here, that is known as the util package. So here we are taking two advanced Java package named as a generic sublet package, means only sublet package. Then I have another part named as a sublet.http package. So these two packages help to design a JSP filter program. So here we can just need to take the help of a predefined class named as a filter, which is already displayed in the slide. That is known as a filter, is a predefined interface. That's why it we know that every type of interfaces are must be implements with a class name. So that's why it is written as a public class, class name as a log filter. It is one variable. Instead of this log filter, user can write any name. Then we need to implements. It's a keyword which helps to implement a interface. Then the interface named as a filter. Then we can start the opening curly braces. In that opening curly braces, we can need to write some statement. In that statement, we are using init method. In that init method, we must have a parameter named as a config. That means the config class contain an object named as a config, and that config object helps to receive a configuration object which is forwarded at the time of execution. And that method must throws an exception. That's why it is written as throws sublet exception. If any type of errors are created in that moment, these type of exceptions are thrown to the catch statement. So in this init method, we have a statement written as string test param equal to config.get int, or you can say init parameter. So this get init parameter, it is known as a method which contains a one name that is known as a test param. That test param is forwarded at the time of invoking that part. So here that config is known as object which is created at the time of filter config class, and it is invoked this get init parameter method. The next statement written as system.out.println test param, we are going to be printing the which type of parameters are received through this config object. So it is displayed in that session. So here we are printing like test param plus test parameter. So we are printing the which type of parameters are received through this get init parameter method. Then we can need to close this initialization method. Whenever user can close this initialization method, then we can start do filter method. In that do filter method must be declared in this way, which is written in this slide, public void do filter. In that filter method, we are using three type of parameter which is shown in this slide. One is known as a sublet request type parameter, then sublet response type parameter, then filter chain parameter. So here we are using three type of parameters: request, response and chain parameter. So by using this three type parameter, we are designing some coding section. So here, and this do filter method also returns some exception. That's why, or we can say throw some exception which is written in this section, like throws space java.io.io exception comma sublet exception. So in this two type of exceptions which are written in this session, by using this throws exception part, we have contained some statement written as string with a object named as IP address equal to request dot get remote addr. Get remote addr means it is known as one remote address which can receive through a request object. Then we have another method named as system.out.println. In that section, we are going to printing the which type of IP address received at the time of invocation. That means if a user is invoking a web page, in that moment our system IP address is automatically tracked by that type of web page, because this kind of web page is written for that. We know that if you consider as an example, in that moment we can consider a one song site. In that moment we can say like that, if a user want to access that song, and whenever user can access that song, in that moment user must showing a specific order, and each and every type of web page must have a reference number. We can say like that, if a user want to download any type of song and that contains some limited pairs, or I can say in a single day we can download 10 songs. Whenever user can already downloaded this 10 type of songs, in that moment that IP address of that system is fully blocked. And how is it possible? With the help of this filter class. If a user is taking the filter class environment, in that moment we are successfully getting a reference part. By using that reference part, we can easily just maintain each and every part of a program which is already defined in their sliding section. So now we can focus on a slide. So in this slide already we have another statement which is written as, just we can say, system.out.println. In this statement we are going to print what is the IP address, logging IP address. Then we are learning what is the real current timestamp address, or you can say timestamp mentioned here. So here we are going to print IP with IP address. Then we have a time zone. In the time zone we are going to printing what are the times are relevant to this session. So the next session we are define as chain dot do filter method. So here we are taking the help of chain object, we can invoke a method which is named as do filter method. So in this do filter method contains two type of parameters, that is known as a request, another known as response. These two parameter must be received at the time of invocation. If a user can invoke this kind of web page, then it is automatically track the IP address of that system, that may be a laptop or that may be a desktop. So this kind of filtering activity is performed in this slide or in this program. Last but not least, here we have another section or another method named as a destroy method, and that destroy method must be invoked or defined like public void destroy. So in this destroy method we can declare a statement, that means, or it may be declared any statement, otherwise you can just print a message. Whenever user can getting this destroy method is automatically release each and every part of a program which are reserved by an object. So here may written as called before the filter instance is removed from service by the web container. Whenever that web container is executed, in that moment we are getting this type of reference, and that reference is written in the form of destroy method. So each and every type of destroy method is automatically invoked at the end of that program. If a program is not successfully executed or not successfully executed, that may be depends on that programming filtering part. So each and every type of web pages or enterprise web pages or business oriented web pages or any social relevant web pages or any type of professional web pages, they are using this kind of filtering activity. Due to that filtering activity, we can successfully maintain each and every part of a program. So if a user never want to design any type of just we can say filtering part need to be added in their application, in that moment we never take the help of this slide. So here we are already mentioned how to add a filtering part and how to execute it and how to easily track the IP address of a system. In the next part we are going to discuss JSP filter mapping in web.xml part. So here in this slide the filters are defined and then map to a URL or JSP file name in much the same way as the sublet is defined, and then map to a URL pattern in web.xml file. So here to need to create the following entry for filter tag in the deployment descriptor which is defined in this web.xml part. So here that web.xml part is gives a brief idea about the reference or you can say configure file about our web page. So here if a user want to define a web.xml file, it contains some statements which is already mentioned in the slide, like we must have a filter tag. In that filter tag contains some sub, just we can say sub tag, that is named as filter name, and that filter name as a log filter, and it should be ended with a pair tag, then another known as a filter class, and that log filter must be executed. You can create a bytecode or class file, and that is referenced in this filter class tag. So next we are going to invoke, like define a init param tag. In that init param tag we can take the help of parameter name or param name, that is written as test param. Then we can mention here param value, that is written as initialization parameter. Then we need to close that init param tag. Finally we can close that filter tag. So next we are defining the mapping of this program, whenever that program should be mapped, because you know that whenever this any type of pages are executed, this web.xml file is automatically invoked. If a user want to invoke this web.xml file, in that moment this part is mostly essentially needed for that session. So here we also define another tag named as filter mapping tag. So in this filter mapping tag we have two another sub tag, that is named as filter name. Similar we can define the log filter. Then we need to define a URL pattern, and that URL pattern is written as a forward slash star, and that forward star it written as, it is known as any type of web pages you can open, automatically that filtering part is executed. There is no need to any type of help which is used in our programming part. So here the above filter will apply to all the sublets and JSP because we specified the forward star in our configuration. You can specify a particular sublet or the JSP path if you want to apply filter on few sublets or JSP only, because if a user want to invoke any type of sublets or any type of JSP program, in that moment these two sessions are essentially needed to execution. So now try to call any sublet or JSP. You will see generated log in your web server log. That means every type of web server must need to be logging automatically or through this web.xml file. So you can use log4j logger. The log4j logger must be executed at the time of invoking this web.xml file. So the evap log in a separate file is automatically executed if a user want to invoking its application according to its requirement. If a user want to design any type of web.xml, it must be taking the help of this filter tag. If that filter tag is not successfully created or we can say not implemented successfully, in that moment we can getting a lots of error. So these two section, like your init param section or filtering mapping section, which is mostly needed for that program. So if a user is never interested for doing this kind of filtering part in their JSP session, in that moment user never put this kind of codings in their web.xml session. First of all, if a user want to design this filtering part, first of all you can create a notepad. In that notepad we must need to write that code. Then that code must be linked through the web.xml file. Whenever that XML file is being ready, then we can automatically invoke that file. It can be automatically invoked at the time of calling or at the time of execution. So in this way we are getting the brief idea about the filtering concept and how it will be implemented in our real project, and it is somehow mostly essential for doing a live project which is need to be securely processed in their field. Okay, finally, thank you. Have a nice day.